Learn how to live better and think better and do better and have better according to God's will and purpose for your life. Welcome to Table Talk with Tracey Marie.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, everybody. Welcome to Table Talk. This is Tracey Marie, and I am so glad that you are with me today. Thank you so much for taking some of your time out to be with me today. And we have a wonderful show lined up for you. We have the conclusion of the show that I did last week with Prophetess Lizsolette Williams. And I hope that you guys were able to tune into that show. If you weren't, please listen in. You can go to tabletalkradioshow.com and you can listen in. That we talked about the prophetic giftings and do I have the prophetic gift. But today, as we were talking last weekend, the Lord just led us, as we came from that, he led us into another discussion. And we were talking about church hurt. And I want to ask you guys a question. For most of you out there, if you knew that someone was being physically or mentally or sexually abused, and they stayed in the relationship that they were in, most people would say, why is that person staying there? Why are they allowing themselves to be treated that way? You know, why won't they leave? That's what most people would say. So I ask you this, why is it that if a person is at a church where they are being hurt or wounded or misled or stifled in their growth or being taught incorrectly, any of those things, and they are experiencing abuse from leadership, why do people stay? That's a good question. And a lot of people do, because they really believe that everything that they're going through is the enemy. Or they believe that they're supposed to endure those things because they have to submit and surrender to leadership, regardless of how they're treated. So Lizsolette and I talked about that, and what she's going to share with us is her personal testimony as to what she went through when she experienced church hurt and abuse from her leadership. And she's going to talk about that experience and how the Lord delivered her and set her free from that. So we're going to get into that. But before we even do that, you know how I do. You guys had a busy week this week, whether it was work, whether it was school or the kids or your family or ministry. So before we get started, I just want you guys to sit back if you can, wherever you are. And just relax. And I'm going to bring to you Fred Hammond and Radical for Christ. And I just want you to let the song minister to you. And I want you to focus on the goodness of God and just how wonderful he is and how he kept you. He kept us this week. He provided for us. He protected us. He kept us from danger, seen and unseen. How awesome he is. So just take a few moments to just get in his presence and just begin to speak to him and talk to him so that you can begin to receive whatever it is the Lord has for you today. And I'm going to be right back with some more Table Talk.
Bread of life sent down the glory. Many think you were on earth a holy king, a carpenter. been tired, but you are the living word thing now. Come on. Come on, Houston, you can say it one time with us. Bring, send down from glory, many things. Come on, somebody say it.
Many things you were on earth, a holy king, a conquering God. You are the living
word.
Gentile
Redeemer, God with us,
God with us, the living truth, and what a friend we have in you.
This is what we like to call you, Jesus, Jesus. That's what we call you, yeah. You were born in a manger, but on a tree you died to save man.
The
Jesus, Jesus,
Jesus.
That's what we call you.
Table Talk and with Tracey Marie and our special guest, Prophetess Lizsolette Williams. And if you were here with us last weekend, you heard the conversation that we were talking about, and we were basically talking about the prophetic, and, you know, we talked about the call and just some of the things that we experienced. We also talked about the differences between, like, the psychics and the prophet and just those things that happen in the body of Christ that ought not be happening when it comes to the prophetic, and not just the prophetic, but other gifts as well. It was a lot of stuff we covered. I hope you did get to hear that show. If not, you can always go to the website, and the show is up there so that you can download it or play it right there on the website. But we're going to continue today because, like I said, last week, Lizsolette, the Lord showed her some things, and she shared those things with me, and I asked her if she was able to share it with you, and she is. So, Lizsolette, what I want to talk about with you is, in this season, as I told you, you know, God is speaking to his prophets, and yes, he has shown us some things. And what, you know, I think the thing that I really, I guess you could say I'm excited simply because I know that what God said he's going to do, but I'm also, I guess, a little discouraged because it's like you feel to yourself that it didn't have to be this way and people would just be obedient and hear God. And so can you share what God has shown you, share with the audience what the Lord has shown you concerning his church?
Definitely. What's really on my heart right now is just first to even share what I was in and how he brought me out.
Okay.
I was in a ministry where I was serving faithfully for, I'm not to say 5 years, that's too much shy of 5 years. I was the assistant to both pastors. I was both of their armor bearer.
Okay.
I was the church administrator. I was over the single women's ministry. And I'm not saying this as a boast, but just to give the idea of, to people of how engrafted and rooted I was into the ministry.
Okay.
And when I first went there, I went there upon the word of the Lord to go. And I was there for years. And I started feeling tired, feeling drained. I started losing a passion for prayer. You know, that was something else. I was part of the intercessory team. And it was like everything became obligation.
Okay.
And it got to the point where I was crying out to the Lord because as much as I loved him,
mm-hmm,
I wanted nothing to do with his health anymore,
mm-hmm,
because there was,
yes,
there was no sense of balance. I felt like I didn't have a life. Being that I'm not married and single, I was told things like, you have to, single people, if any person you need to be in a church, and then working at the church full time.
Yes.
I,
yes,
was there sometimes 6-7 days out the week.
Mm-hmm.
You know, first one there, last one to leave. And it's,
mm-hmm,
cool in the beginning. It's cool for a season because you're
mm-hmm
doing it because you truly love God.
That's,
and you,
right,
want to serve him. You, all he's done for you, you just want to show the Lord how much you love him,
okay,
by letting him use you to be a blessing to people.
That's right.
But what starts happening is then you start feeling guilty because now praying is burdensome to you.
Right.
Getting up out the bed and going to service has become a burden. Being put on this church face and you're miserable and you feel like you're dying on the inside, but now you
can
have
just
to go,
wait a minute,
perform.
I'm sorry, Lizsolette. I feel like you're telling my story. Why do I feel,
wow,
like you're telling my story?
Oh,
because my,
you know,
Lizsolette, I went,
yes,
through this. Listen, and I also, because I was divorced and I was,
mm-hmm,
a single mom. And,
wow,
they made, I was made to feel like if you love God, you're supposed to be here every time. And I was on the praise team. And,
yes,
you know, and I was really, you know, going to Bible study and you know, whatever was going on. And I mean, even when it was stuff like, okay, they're having a banquet or they're having, you know, their conferences or whatever they were doing. And you got to be here every time with the door open if you love the Lord. And I was made to feel like if I really love God, then I need to be at this church every time. But then I started saying to myself, but wait a minute. I am working to take care of my children. I still have to be a mother. I still have to take care of my home. Mm-hmm. I still have to keep my life in order. And so nobody's helping me with that. But you want me to be here to assist you in everything that's going on. And I felt so burdened. And I told God, I said, God, if this is all it is in serving you, I'm getting ready to leave. I'm getting ready to quit. I said, God, I love you, but where is this freedom and liberty that you're talking about?
Oh, please say that. Yes.
I said, God, I said, I am bound. I said, I am tired. I'm not happy. I said, what is going on here? And then that's when God said, the reason why you're not happy is because you're more concerned with pleasing man instead of pleasing me. I said, my God.
Oh, now, let me tell you about this. When you just said that, I was so headstrong and angry with the Lord. You know, I like to check me. Okay, God, what's going on with me? What's going on with me? What's going on with me? What's wrong with me? Why am I feeling this way? That I never have a tendency to never shift when he's not saying I'm a problem.
Right.
And I'll keep the burden on me like something's wrong with me.
Mm-hmm.
And what happened was I would get mad at God and be like, this is your man of God. And your word is saying that you have to honor the man of God. So I feel like I'm stuck because if I speak up, then I'm coming against your leadership, you know, the whole touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm. And
girl.
That being taught to me, programs in my mind. If I speak how I really feel, I'm dishonoring the man of God, so then God's going to get upset with me. So then I felt like I was in a no-win situation.
Girl, and this is the thing. And, I believe people out there, I know some of you out there have to be listening. You definitely can relate to what we're talking about. And I'm telling you, and I think that's why we have that same kind of passion, and God is speaking to us and speaking to us and telling us the things, and that's why we connect the way we do, and we're hearing the same things. And it's like, my God, but it was like, Lord, I just felt like, okay, touch not my anointed, but wait a minute, God, does that mean I'm not anointed?
Yes.
I mean, are they, because it was like you were made to feel like we're here and you're there. And, you know, we have a special anointing, and so you must reverence that. And it was like, you have got to be kidding me. Where is Jesus in this equation? And my thing is, I'm looking at Jesus, and why didn't Jesus act like that? So I totally get where you are with that. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Oh, no, you're fine, sis. You are fine. See, for me, it's interesting to see how you were able to see Jesus wasn't in it. I had to go a different route to get the Lord to open my eyes.
But listen, it took me some time. That didn't happen overnight.
Oh, yeah. You took my over, like, almost 5 years.
That's right. This thing took some time.
The last year, I was miserable. When I say everything in my life shut up, where I was, the place where I was staying, I was renting a townhome, was there for, you know, going on 7 years. And the landlord decides he wants to start stealing the rent money and not paying the mortgage.
Right.
Now, I'm getting ready to be forced to move out, find another place. I'm working full-time for the church who knew my expenses, right? And I'm trying not to get on a whole other tangent about that lie about the tithe, but at the time I was a faithful tither, and I didn't care if that meant my water got cut off, if I couldn't pay my rent, if I couldn't pay my partner, what if God was going to get his. That's how dedicated I was to tithing.
That's
In this situation, I didn't have a car. I told them my monthly expenses, so they are paying me, right? Do you know, they know I'm a faithful tither. They started paying me where every month I was $300 in the hole.
My God.
But I'm there six, my 7 days out the week. You my know God. My situation. I'm your personal assistant.
Right.
And I was like, God, where is the love in this?
But not only that, forget if you didn't do anything, but you were just a member. You are
exactly.
a child of God, and you are their sister in the faith. And the
exactly.
Word of God says in James that if your brother or sister come with a need, and you send them away, talking about some go on your way and be blessed. In God's eyes, that's a sin. Because you could have helped them and you should have helped them. But let me tell
right.
you something. I know that. That's why I said, see, this is, I knew it. People out there, I knew it. I knew it. I said, because we were connected so quickly. And I'm just hearing this from Lizsolette about her testimony and what the things she's going through. And I'm going to share this, and then we're going to move on to the next thing. And that is that when I was in church, I was on the, now, same thing with you. I didn't have a car at the time. I'm in mm-hmm. one part of the section. It took me an hour and a half to get to my church from where I lived on SEPTA. And I had both my children. So I had to cover a bus fare for all of us to and fro. Now, I was going to church three times out the week because I had to go Sunday. But then, of course, I went to Bible study. And then I went to the praise and worship team rehearsals. And I remember they were having something at nighttime. Now, they were in a neighborhood that was well-known for crime and shooting
mm-hmm.
and stuff like that. And they were having some type of services at night. And I told them, I said, listen, I can't do that. I said, because I don't want to have my children up there. First of all, these are school nights. I need to make sure that they are tended to with their homework and that they've eaten. And I said, I don't feel comfortable, you know, being on the corner waiting for a bus in that type of environment. Anything can happen. It's just me and my children. I was
yes.
told, if you really have faith in God, you would do that because you have the faith to know he's not going to let anything happen to you. My attitude was then, if you have faith like that, then you have the faith to know that you can let us get in your car and give us a ride home. How about that?
Amen. Amen.
That was my attitude. And that's when I said, you know what, God, this is not you. This is man.
Yes.
So I know where you are. And I believe a lot of people, and I believe that's why a lot of people have left the church, and they've left the church hurt, angry, because they've given so much of themselves. And they really thought that they were doing as unto the Lord. And it wasn't God requiring it. It was man requiring it.
But you know what, sis? I'm so grateful that you said that, because it wasn't until I realized this is not the heart of God concerning
right.
me. When I got to that place of realization within, when I tell you doors open, a job opportunity for me to leave there opened up.
Right.
I got a new and better place across the street from where I lived, cost me $100 less a month.
Wow.
Then I ended up, he ended up cleaning up my credit, so I was able to get a car as if I was a first-time buyer. But
right.
it was at the point of me realizing, God, this is not you.
Right.
This is not you. And then he has to renew our minds and show us himself in his word, the truth. And what we see today, what we call church, that's not
right.
his truth.
And I'm glad that you said that. And believe it or not, we have 10 minutes left. So what I want to
wow.
ask you
yes.
is if you can just, in that time, go ahead and just talk to the people and tell them what the Lord has shown you concerning his church and what's to come.
Yes, ma'am. What the Lord has shown me concerning what we call church is that this is not the church that he has instituted. This is a bunch of men and women who, a lot of them are redoing what they've been taught out of ignorance, and there are some who know this is not right, but they're doing it for the monetary gain.
Right.
It's all about that whole status, that whole image. It is the harlot system. It is Babylon. It is
okay.
not system that God created. It is set up exactly like the business structure in the world. You have your top person. You have your CEO, be it your pastor. And, you know, it's like that whole pyramid where everyone underneath, you know, the workers are on the bottom, and then it goes up and everything flows up. Well, in the kingdom of God, everything comes down
mm-hmm.
from the head down. You have pastors who abuse their so-called God-given authority. God never calls anyone to lord over anyone. Mm-hmm. The only Lord we have is Lord Jesus. Mm-hmm. But you have pastors who will tell you, you know, they're the authority, they're your covering, and then when you don't understand who the Lord is and who you are to the Lord, and you subject yourself to that, you come under witchcraft.
Yes.
And you don't even realize, because your heart is right towards the Lord, you really want to serve him, but what ends up happening is they become your God.
And what people need to understand, when you say witchcraft, people automatically think the one, you know, the old lady with the big pointy hat and the little and the thing on her nose. No, we're not talking about that. People need to understand that there are many manifestations that fall under the spirit of witchcraft. Some of those manifestations are control, domination, and manipulation. And what happens is that manipulation and control and domination is when somebody can try to create some type of power over you to get you to do what they want you to do, even if it's not right.
Yes.
And people don't want to understand it. And you think, oh, can't nobody manipulate me? Listen, I said this earlier during another interview, and I said that if you are doing something, and I told you, I said, this is how you know you are an idolater or you are in idolatry. If the man or woman of God is bringing the truth to you and they are showing you the word of God and showing you his truth, and then you sit there and say, well, that's not what my pastor teaches. Honey, that's idolatry. And you've been manipulated, okay?
Yes.
So a lot of people are following traditions that were man-made that have absolutely nothing to do with God and what God has called us and how he has called us to live and to serve him. But, okay, so you keep – okay, so go ahead. I'm sorry, when you spoke that, I had to speak on that with the witchcraft thing, but you basically were saying that, you know, people are under the spirit of witchcraft and don't even realize it.
You don't. And don't realize, you know, when the Lord says you've left your first love. This is why so many times people say they lost the joy of their salvation, because now it's become, what does man require of me to be saved? What is man saying that if I love God, then I'll do this, then I'll do that? Matthew 23, Jesus goes off on the Pharisees, the religious rulers of today. That is exactly what we're dealing with today in what we call church.
Yes.
But what I've been seeing the Lord doing is pulling people out, deprogramming and training truth and setting us free and putting us in that place of liberty and connecting people who are in the same place spiritually.
Amen.
And what's funny about it is we're called, you know, we're the ones that say, oh, they don't fell off, they full of the devil now, they this, they that, and we can still walk in love towards them and pray for them and intercede for the Lord to open their eyes to the fact that they are so bound in deception and idolatry, they don't even know it.
That's so true. And they will argue you down.
Yes.
And that's the sad thing, that the truth is right, but you've been so brainwashed that you don't even, you can't even accept the truth. And that's cultist. That's a cult. That's like a cult.
Yes.
Because you're not following Christ. You're following man.
Sis, there's something that is really strong that I feel like I need to share. It's so subtle that when you are in this system called the church, you are initially embraced in this love dorm. So that's filling a void, and you're really believing that God is filling that void by love going you through these people. But that spirit is able to discern where that void is and how to pull you in, how to befriend you, how to pull you in close. So now you're sitting here feeling and getting that need met through a person when you're thinking, is God doing it to them, but it's not. And that's just seduction, because it's so subtle.
Yes.
You feel like you feel safe. Yes. You feel like you're finally loved. You feel like you're finally accepted. That you're finally, you know, going to be rewarded. You feel all these little insecure things. That little girl, that little boy inside of you is finally feeling safe.
Right.
You don't realize the source is not the Lord. You're being seduced. And then as soon as you start trying to come into yourself, as soon as you start trying to blossom and grow and it doesn't fit their pattern, they start to rebuke you and talk about you from the pulpit. And you know the blows are against you. And you're not going to understand it because these are the people who say they love you. So then you start doubting yourself.
That's right. And I've seen it happen. My God. My God.
There's so many people hurting right now.
Yes.
And it's the love that we have for God is used against us.
That's right. And people need to understand, you know, if you are going to your pastor or any leader more than you are God,
yes,
that's a problem. That's a problem. Because God said in his word, seek him first.
Yes.
Okay? So the same energy or time that it took you to pick up that phone or to get in that car to drive to that church or whatever, is you could have fallen to your knees and
yes,
you could have talked to your father. And a true leader is going to always lead you back to God through Jesus.
Yeah.
Always.
That's it right there.
And when you
that's
are under
right
good leadership, you are going to find yourself in your word more. You're going to find yourself praying more. You're going to find yourself praising and worshiping more. You're going to find yourself starting to elevate in all of those levels. You're
yes,
going to see that. You're going to see that 6 months ago you weren't praying the way you pray now. You weren't talking to the Lord, or you weren't worshiping the way you worship now. You weren't in your word. Now the scripture comes to your recollection as soon as you think of something. You get a scripture that comes right to your recollection because you've been in your word. That's how you know you're growing. But when you find yourself, I got to go talk to my pastor about this. I got to go talk to the deacon about this. Then they're not doing their job.
Mm-hmm.
And another thing, I have to say this. This is something that I shared with a very good friend of mine, and I told her, another thing that leaders do that they ought not do, and that is they don't release you in due season. And what I mean by that is I don't care how long you've been at a church. If God says it's time to move, you move.
Yes.
You don't stay somewhere out of loyalty. Your loyalty is with the Lord. And a lot of times, pastors or leaders, they try to, and it was something you said, Lizalette, you said, covet someone's anointing or their gift for their own benefit. So they know that you've already, your season at that church is done. But they will, when the Lord tells you it's time to go, you'll go to them for their blessing, and they'll say, I don't feel that in my spirit. It's not time for you to go yet.
Sis, please. When it was time for me to leave, exactly. The Lord, it was sold to the point of you are overdue. You send them an email and tell them you are not coming back. You know, you go to this last service. The Holy Spirit, I'm going to give them the opportunity to release you correctly. But they are not going to. They're going to tell you don't bother coming, but you go anyway. And do you know that is exactly what happened?
My God, and what kind of love is that?
And I'm the one that the people look to as far as like, okay, we know she's her assistant and this and that. And it's not, you know, it's not about me, but it was like, do you realize the hurt that that's going to cause people? Because when I stop showing up and nothing has been said, that's going to be an issue for people.
Like you never existed.
And you know, one thing that I just want to encourage people, because when the Lord tells you to come out, if you don't leave, he's going to create a situation to get you out.
Yes, he will.
And those
yes,
are painful situations.
Yes.
And see, when he told me, you know, they're not going to properly release you, then his next thing was, and I'm going to use you to open the eyes of others. I was like, oh, Lord, I'm going to become this demon-infested child now. And sure enough, when people realized that I was no longer going there was multitudes who left the church because they were already seeing stuff. They were just praying, asking God for a confirmation. And when I left, they said, hold up. If she left, then I know what I'm seeing is right. And they got up and they got out. I got attacked on Facebook. I couldn't even put a post on Facebook about religious things going on within the overall body of the Christ. I never called them out. I never said their name. I never said the ministry name. I never did that. But do you know he would take my post, and whether it was Bible study or Sunday service, that's what he talked about?
My God.
It was like,
I believe it.
I would be getting phone calls. Girl, stay prayed up. Stay prayed up. Then he went to the extreme of saying, I see y'all liking people's status on Facebook. If you're going to be here, then you're going to be here with me, or you go over there with her. I'm drawing my line in the sand. You better cut off all communication with her.
My God.
That grieved me so bad. Not because you're attacking me.
Right.
But because the people were so blind to see. That is not the heart and the love of God.
Right.
How can you not see that that is not the heart of God?
That's not. No, it is not.
God reconciles.
Yes, he does.
He's all about reconciliation.
Yes, he does. Yes, he does.
But when you come out of that, when your eyes are opened, they will assault you, try to tear your reputation down. And I just want to encourage people, if you are in that place right now, you just continue to trust the Lord.
Amen.
Because what happens is the enemy exposes himself in what they're doing.
Yes.
Because more and more people will start seeing the truth. And I have people to this day, out the blue, who will contact me to find out the truth.
Yes.
Who have left.
My God. You know what, you guys? And we are already at the end. And Lizsolette, I want you to come back. So we're definitely going to set up another time for you to come back so we can really continue to get in depth about some things, because I definitely want them to understand what is coming. Matter of fact, what's already here based upon the judgment on the church and what God is going to be doing. He's already shown his prophets some things, and I want them to be aware of that so that they understand that, listen, God, the reason why God is calling us to speak to you, and when I say us, God has chosen he has pulled from the background to the front. He has called a specific people that have had relationship with him, who have been humble and weren't looking for fame, fortune, attention, or anything, but were serving him with a sincere heart and were obedient to him through trials and tribulations and tests and everything, his faithful ones. He is bringing them forth to speak truth. Why? Because God is bringing forth judgment. And the thing is, he wants you to, just the same way he got Lot and his family out of Sodom and Gomorrah, and he told them never to look back again,
mm-hmm.
God is calling his children out. The word of God in Revelation, come out of her. Come out of her. Okay? And so God is calling his children out, and he's bringing this to you so that you know what's going on. Not for you to know. And this is the thing. Whatever you get from us today, pray about it. Seek the Lord about it.
Yes.
So that you
yes.
have, and I'm going to tell you something. You will have a peace in your spirit. God will give you a peace once you've sought him, that no matter what's going on around you, you will have peace in whatever it is he has told you to do.
Yes.
Don't you ever just take what anybody says. You always seek the Lord. And so thank you so much, Lizsolette, for just sharing today, being transparent. I know I wish we had more time to just continue to talk. But like I said, I'm going to have you come back so that we can continue to talk and talk more in depth about the prophetic as well as what the Lord is doing. And we just both encourage you out there that we love you with the love of Christ and that no matter where you are, no matter what you've done, no matter the mistakes you've made, it does not matter. Maybe you are at a church that's not healthy and it's dysfunctional and you know it and you were scared to leave. God, first of all, never gave us the spirit of fear.
Amen.
So you already know that that's not God. But seek the Lord so that you can live the life that he has called you to live, which is freedom and liberty. He does not want you bound, and he doesn't want you subject. He has not called anyone to lord or rule over you. That is why Jesus died.
Amen.
Okay? So We encourage you today, that, and I pray that there was something that was said that helped you and that is going, that has challenged you to seek the Lord and seek His truth so that you have complete understanding of His will and purpose for your life.
Yes.
And Lizsolette, like I said, I thank you so much for being with me. I enjoyed this. I told you it was going to go by fast, didn't I?
Yes, you did. And I,
didn't I say it?
Enjoyed it. Yes, you did.
Yes. Because when we talk, when you're passionate about God, oh, Lord, that time goes by so fast. Because you can,
too
honey,
fast.
When we talk about everything that God has done for us, oh, yes. My God, we could talk all day about what He's done for us.
Yes, ma'am.
So I just thank you, and I love you, sister, and you will be back. And everybody, I want you to stay tuned because we're going to be right back with some more Table Talk.
Well, that was an awesome show, powerful. And I thank Lizsolette so much for being open and just being transparent. Guys, we need that. We need people that are willing to stand up and be transparent and talk about what they've been through, what the Lord has brought them out of. We can't get caught up in worrying about what people are going to say or what they're going to think, because you're going to always have people that have judgments or criticisms or naysay. Who cares? Jesus didn't care about his nakedness or, you know, how embarrassing it looked for him to be on the cross and to be beaten and to be mocked and humiliated. He didn't care because the bigger picture and the bigger purpose was that so many would be saved because of his sacrifice. So I thank Lizsolette so much for that, and I pray that something was said that encouraged you and that really revealed some things to you. Maybe this was confirmation for you. But the Lord woke me up last night, and he gave me this scripture, and I want to share it with you, because last year, 2013, God started talking to me then about judgment upon leadership, that his sheep had been scattered and they were wounded and they were hurt. And he started talking to me about what it was he was going to do. But last night, the Lord woke me up out of my sleep and gave me the scripture, and I want to share it with you. It is Ezekiel 34, and it's verse 7 through 16. But if you have the opportunity, I want you to read the whole thing so that you have complete understanding. But this is what your Father is saying. He says, "Therefore, you shepherds, hear the word of the Lord. As surely as I live, declares the sovereign Lord, because my flock lacks a shepherd and so has been plundered and has become food for all the wild animals, and because my shepherds did not search for my flock but cared for themselves rather than for my flock, therefore, you shepherds, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says. I am against the shepherds and will hold them accountable for my flock. I will remove them from tending the flock so that the shepherds can no longer feed themselves. I will rescue my flock from their mouths, and it will no longer be food for them. For this is what the sovereign Lord says. I myself will search for my sheep and look after them. As a shepherd looks after his scattered flock when he is with them, so will I look after my sheep. I will rescue them from all the places where they were scattered on a day of clouds and darkness. I will bring them out from the nations and gather them from the countries, and I will bring them into their own land. I will pasture them on the mountains of Israel and the ravines and in the settlements of the land. I will tend them in a good pasture, and the mountain heights of Israel will be their grazing land. There they will lie down in good grazing land, and there they will feed in a rich pasture on the mountains of Israel. I myself will tend my sheep and have them lie down, declares the sovereign Lord. I will search for the lost and bring back the strays. I will bind up the injured and strengthen the weak, but the sleek and the strong I will destroy. I will shepherd the flock with justice. Hallelujah. That is what the Lord is doing. That is what he is preparing. And he is sending forth his army to go out and tear down these idols of man-made traditions, false doctrines, and abuse to his children. So for that, you better rejoice. For all of you out there who have dealt with church hurt, being wounded, being hurt, being misled, being taught false doctrine, false prophecies, God is coming to rescue you. He is coming to rescue his children. Hallelujah. I get excited about it. So please be obedient when the Lord is telling you to do something. Don't get caught up in what people are going to think. You do what thus saith the Lord. Whew! I love you guys so much. And as always, I want you to live better, think better, do better, and have better according to God's will and purpose for your life. Please visit us at tabletalkradioshow.com. And until next Saturday with our next topic, I'm going to see you when I see you.